This video is made possible by Skillshare. Learn anything with Skillshare for free for 2 months by being one of the first 500 to sign up using the link below. This is Africa, and this is the Sahara Desert, a pile of sand that's about the same size as the United States. Living inside of this enormous area are only 2.5 million people. So imagine taking the country of Slovenia and spreading everybody out who live there across China, and you'll get an idea of just how desolate it is. There is evidence, though, that not too long ago, the entire Sahara used to be green. For the past few hundred thousand years, the Sahara has switched back and forth between a desert and a grassland over and over every 41,000 years because of the long-term changes in Earth's rotation messing up the location of the North African monsoon. The next time that the Sahara will turn green naturally this way will be in about 15,000 years or in 17,000 AD, but humanity is nothing if not grossly impatient. Imagining the course of human history with a green Sahara would be radically different. The Sahara has always been a giant and obvious barrier for travel between the Mediterranean and sub-Saharan Africa. Thousands of kilometers of desert, rough Atlantic waters in the west, and the lack of many markets south of Morocco prevented pre-modern explorers from ever getting past it. Centralized states like Egypt, Carthage, the Romans, Byzantines, and Islamic empires surrounded the desert in the north and the east, but all of them failed to control or expand beyond the desert. In an alternate history scenario where the Sahara is green, all of this changes and it enables these states to expand their influence deep into the African heartland. Even in modern times, turning the Sahara green somehow would revolutionize the entire world and open up a titanic amount of land for colonization and settlement by the world's ever-growing population. One of the most modern attempts at doing this so far was a plan developed nearly 100 years ago to create an artificial sea in the middle of it all, right here in Egypt. The plan doesn't seem too crazy at first, but progressively gets more and more insane as this video goes on. But first, a quick geography lesson. This part of the Sahara is called the Katara Depression, and it's an unusual anomaly in the Sahara because it's almost entirely beneath sea level. It's almost twice the size of Lebanon, contains the second lowest point on the African continent at -133 meters below sea level, and practically nobody lives here. There's only one village with a population of just 363 people. If you move those people out, you basically have a big empty hole in the ground that you could fill up with water to match sea level and give yourself, in effect, the world's 13th largest lake. Hopefully, this would start to alter the weather around this part of the desert to be more livable. You'd turn a useless, basically uninhabited patch of desert into thousands of kilometers of prime beachfront property. And either way, you'd have a nice new lake for fishing, harbors, and new trade routes for you to develop. The first person who argued that we should flood this entire area and create a big ol' sea in the middle of the desert was a guy named John Ball back in 1933. But being so empty of people and being so low beneath sea level are only two out of three things on the checklist needed to flood something this huge. A lot of other places in the world have both of those things, like Death Valley in California or the Turpan Depression in China. The reason why nobody has ever suggested turning either of those places into seas is because of the problem that you'd face with getting water there. The Turpan Depression is thousands of kilometers inland away from any significant body of water, but the Katara Depression is only a mere 55 kilometers away from the Mediterranean Sea at its narrowest point. By 1964, a German engineer named Friedrich Bossler was making a strong case to dig a canal from the Mediterranean that would move water into the empty Katara. His plan was to dig a canal 55 kilometers long by 60 meters deep that would flood the Katara with Mediterranean seawater 60 meters deep, which would take 10 years to do. For reference, the nearby Suez Canal is 193 kilometers long by 24 meters deep, which isn't too different. But in the case of the Katara, the new sea would be located deep inside of the blazing hot Sahara, obviously, which means that the water in this new sea would be evaporating quickly. To take advantage of this, Bossler intended that the water inflow from the canal would eventually match the evaporation rate of the water already in the lake. This would ensure that the lake would remain at a constant level and a constant inflow of water would be moving in, which would create an opportunity to generate some electricity off of it. Bossler's power station, built along the canal where the water flow was strongest, would be capable of generating 6,800 megawatts of electricity, which would be the 8th highest capacity of any power station anywhere in the world even today. But the biggest problems facing the project weren't any technical limitations, they were economic ones. Bossler's calculations showed that the price tag for building such a canal was simply too high for both investors and the Egyptian government to accept. So being the rational guy that he was, Bossler came up with another solution that he thought would make everybody happy. Nuke the shit out of the ground. His new plan called to dig 213 boreholes in a line across the 55-kilometer stretch of land between the Qatara and the Mediterranean. A 1.5 megaton nuclear bomb was then to be placed inside each of these boreholes, each one being 100 times more powerful than the atomic bomb dropped on Hiroshima. 25,000 people were supposed to be evacuated from the area, and then all 213 nukes were to be detonated at once in what would have been the greatest explosion in human history. The holes that they would have punched into the ground would have dug most of the 55-kilometer long canal in an instant, and construction crews were then supposed to go in and tidy it all up. But obviously, there were going to be some problems with this method too. First, all the radiation from 213 huge nukes going off in a small place probably wouldn't make for a pleasant journey for boats to make along the canal into the new sea. Second, the massive shockwave from that blast might have affected the tectonically unstable Red Sea rift between the African and Arabian plates in an unpredictable manner. Third, the land itself between the Qatara and the Mediterranean has over 3 million active landmines left over from the Second World War that are becoming increasingly unstable. Detonating nukes, building complicated canals, and moving thousands of workers across an active minefield would probably cause a few accidents to happen. Needless to say, when Bossler presented this completely serious idea to the Egyptian government, they gave him a pretty firm no, and the entire plan was discarded into the trash heap of failed crazy ideas. I'm sure that you have a long list of your own crazy ideas though, but not all of them require nukes to solve. It's a key part of the human experience to set goals and continuously develop your set of skills to help with those goals. Just like I've been developing my writing skills by watching this course by Wendover Productions about how to make an educational video essay over at Skillshare, you can really learn about any number of topics on Skillshare, like how to maintain your productivity by my friend Thomas Frank, or how to animate your own YouTube video by my friends at Kurzgesagt. The new year is a perfect time to set some goals and learn a valuable life skill. You can teach yourself pretty much anything online these days, and Skillshare is a perfect place for you to do it. With professional and easy to understand classes that follow a clear learning curve, you can jump right in and begin learning how to do the work or hobbies that you love. A premium membership starts around $10 a month for unlimited access to all courses, but the first 500 people to sign up using this link in the description will get their first 2 months for free. And as usual, thank you for watching, and I'll see you again next week.